Mrs. Sunity Best, Mr. Orville London, members of the Lloyd Best Institute, Caribbean citizens and compatriots, friends and comrades, good morning. Let me first of all congratulate the organizers for responding to the urgency of the moment in initiating this dialogue on the search for a new politics and a more meaningful democracy. As your conference documents have noted, it is now 50 years since the first English-speaking Caribbean states attained independence. To many of us, these have been 50 years of marking time, trial and error, false starts, and dashed expectations, with some successes, but many more disappointments. It has been 15 years of living with the reality that we could have done better, and that we are operating below our capacity. And if a search for a more optimistic reading of how we have fared in those 50 years were to be offered, the most that we can say is that we have held our own in the midst of crises and despite resource and size constraints. In fact, many a political party has launched an electoral campaign on precisely these terms. But no positive spin can escape the reality that we are much further behind than where we ought to have been. So it is in this context of our 50-year experience that we meet to engage in deep reflection, to take stock, to take a fresh guard in order that we can move forward with clarity, purpose, and confidence. And I want to congratulate the Lloyd Best Institute for initiating this dialogue. I also want to congratulate you on your work in fulfilling the legacy of Lloyd Best. In both your recognition of the challenges of the moment and in your convening of this convoi in response to them, you are being true to the political DNA that you have inherited. If there was one thing which singled out Lloyd Best from other Caribbean political thinkers, it was his never-ending search for specific Caribbean responses to distinctive Caribbean reality, as you've heard from Mrs. Best. Lloyd Best was matched perhaps only by Jose Marti in his insistence that we in the Americas and the Caribbean were a wholly new people, and as such, we constitute the basis for an authentic, original, and autonomous civilization. What separated Lloyd Best from Marti and others was his never-ending effort at inventing and creating new and concrete models of government, economy, and social life. Whilst others simply pointed out the fact that we were a unique region and people, Best set about demonstrating its existence and contributing to its construction. It is this which drove his demand for the need for independent thought, which fueled his research into the new models of the Caribbean economy, and which pushed him to propose new forms of governance suited to our condition as a unique people and civilization. Central to Lloyd Best was the requirement that we should not only talk but act. He said to us that if we are dissatisfied with the body of doctrine that we have inherited, let us begin to work afresh. If we think the existing media frustrate dialogue, let us found new ones that are not. If we think economic development requires the restriction of consumption, let us restrict our own and get on with it. Whatever we say we believe, let us live it now. So this is the impulse to act which I sense that you have inherited from your founding father. So in meeting here to explore the issue of a new politics and new forms of representation, you are therefore fulfilling the work of your founder. So I wish to congratulate you for honoring his spirit and for respecting his name and memory and for continuing his legacy. Given my recognition of the seriousness with which you approach your work and your commitment to honoring Lloyd Best's memory, I therefore wish to thank you for bestowing upon me the privilege of addressing you today and to express my gratitude for the confidence that you have shown in me in the bestowing of the responsibility that comes with the privilege. I wish also to add that both the responsibility and the privilege have been rendered even more weighty by my knowledge of the fact that I was recommended to you by the Caribbean literary and intellectual giant George Lamming. Let me therefore assure you, Chairman, of my deep sensitivity to both the honor that your confidence in me implies, as well as the responsibility which the occasion carries. And let me also indicate to you my intention, Chair, to validate both the honor and the privilege. In preparing for today's convoi, I wanted to find a piece of writing and a statement that captures the problems of our democracy and our politics in the present moment. In searching, I was gifted the following piercing analysis which summarizes the problems of Caribbean politics and Caribbean democracy as we enter the second decade of the 21st century, 50 years after independence. That piece of literature which I found went as follows. The framers of our political constitution for independence had, like their federal predecessors, displayed great energy and little, if any, creativity. With very minor deviations, we readily assumed the garb of Westminster, and our members of the new parliament, bewigged and frock-coated, took their opposite seats as Her Majesty's government and Her Majesty's loyal opposition. We still have our two political parties well balanced one against the other, and only occasionally disturbed by rumors of a third. We have our speaker, our cabinet, our front benchers, our back benchers, our Hansard, and all the trappings. We are sometimes praised for the stability of our two-party system, the envy is assumed of other Commonwealth nations, in whose governments one party clearly dominates, and of course, the democratic example to the wayward Cubans. The facade is impressive. Let us look behind it. In going behind the facade, the writer found even more in the Caribbean to cause him concern. He goes on, vote for me and you might get a job. Vote for my opponent and if I win, you probably won't. Harass my opponent in his electoral campaign and get a handout for a meal. The parties have no need for philosophies other than the simple creed of bribery. Indeed, as some well-meaning politicians have discovered, to have a policy and a program might be dangerous. The strongest position is one of non-commitment to anything but to the party. Ideologies and principles are dangerous. Flexibility and room for maneuver are all important. And still, the writer persists with his piercing diagnosis. I suggest one ailment in common, the beginning of the breakdown of parliamentary democracy as we are accustomed to think of it in terms of party political organization. Perhaps then, the trouble is that we have come into possession of an obsolescent system. Whatever the cause, it appears that the system of government which we have inherited from Britain is inappropriate, perhaps to the needs and circumstance of the Caribbean people. And then he goes on to prescribe. Familiarity need not breed contempt, but it will certainly wash away mystery, awe, and majesty. The judge looks less formidable in his wig and gown if we have often seen him in his shorts. There is consequently some compensation in smallness. It can lead to straighter talking and to the substitution of earned respect for pomp and circumstance. But here, that will take time. In the days of slavery, in the traditional hierarchy of the estate personnel in the system of concurrent government, communication ran for the most part in a one-way traffic downwards. The high officials and the bosses issued the orders which were passed on to those who passed them on to others who carried them out. This is no longer true. Trade unionism and adult suffrage have given importance to the voice of the laborer. But we are still reluctant to risk the talent of authority. In the long years of our history, that has been a dangerous exercise. Nowadays, moreover, even though we feel freer to offer criticism, we are little practiced in the arts of discussion and inquiry. We deal rather in assertion and counter-assertion, in which the louder and the stronger frequently silence those who might be right. Whilst I said that the statement was relevant to our present time, I did not say that it was of recent vintage. If you are thinking that this statement was written in and for our present time, you would be wrong. It was written by Douglas Hall, the former Governor General of Jamaica, not in 2012, not 50 years after independence, but in 1972, only one decade after Jamaican independence. In prefacing my comments with Douglas Hall's statement, I have deliberately omitted all references to Jamaica and all time-specific references in order to make a very simple point. And the point is this, that the problem of making the Caribbean political problem, the political system relevant to our needs is an old, stubborn, intractable problem that generations of Caribbean people have been grappling with and in response to which many prescriptions have been offered. So in approaching the problem, I come not with new solutions, not to represent what others before me have offered with greater technical finesse and political insight and clarity. Instead, I come at the tail end, 50 years later, to speak to a new generation, and I'm happy that many of that new generation is here with us today, to speak to that new generation still grappling with the old problem, and to suggest that today we are living in a moment of greater possibility of achieving our goal in ushering a new politics for the Caribbean. I have come with the hope of demonstrating that the moment is now. So it is in this spirit I wish to frame my discussion with you today. I have been asked to speak specifically on the topic of new politics searching for representation. Your choice of topic, I sense, has been motivated by a realization that your previous post-colonial experience of democracy has been weighed in the balance and it has been found wanting. I also sense that you would like to hear some concrete proposals in order to make your dialogue more meaningful. In my talk today, therefore, I wish to fulfill your terms of reference by engaging in both diagnosis and some prescription. I will therefore endeavor to do the following. First, I will speak specifically to the question of the representation deficit or the failure of representational politics. I present a brief diagnosis of what are the specific challenges to Caribbean democracy that we are faced with in the present. I will emphasize the present because, as I have sought to show with the Douglas Hall statement, and as you know very well through the work of Lloyd Best, the problem of finding a new and relevant model of governance in the Caribbean has been old as the Caribbean independence itself. In diagnosing, therefore, I will give a general account of the Caribbean condition, showing how the world has changed since the 50 years of independence, and how the new reality has challenged the economic and political assumptions upon which Caribbean independence had been pursued. Secondly, I will move from a general reading of the Caribbean condition to identifying the specific ways in which the failures, reversals, and shortcomings in representative politics are reflected. Finally, I will conclude with some prescriptive comment. I wish to add that, unlike what has been attempted before, my prescriptions will not be specific. One of the dangers in prescribing is the pitfall of speaking in a social and economic vacuum. No political order ever exists suspended in air. Every political order is merely a reflection of the possibilities allowed by the material and economic social circumstances in which the politics is played out. The political system is always a reflection of the outcome of political contestation between competing interests within the limits of what the economic material conditions will allow. As Karl Marx has put it, while men make history, they do not make it in conditions of their own choosing. Indeed, one of the weaknesses of Lloyd Best, if I may be permitted to speak of a weakness, and others like him who have attempted to prescribe detailed accounts of what a future democratic form may look like, is that often their prescriptions have been presented in a social and economic vacuum. Political forms are only determined in the context of concrete politics and concrete practice. In fact, many a taken-for-granted political practice was discovered only in the midst of real struggle, without which those forms would never see the light of day. It is only actual struggle and political practice which can truly determine what is possible. For these reasons, therefore, my prescriptions will come not in the form of detailed description of what a new executive or legislature should look like, or how many members should sit in this chamber, or how many members should sit in that body. There are far too many constitutional experts in here for me to dare to tread on their ground. Instead, I will endeavor to provide an account of the concrete political moment of the present, showing what I think it is possible and why I am proposing now that we are on the threshold of a new politics and a new democracy. If I am able to achieve those things, I think I would have fulfilled the task asked of me here today, and I would have provided the convoi with a basis for some discussion. In discussing the challenges to our politics and the challenges of representation 50 years after independence, we should not lead ourselves to the conclusion that the problems are new. Whilst those 50 years have provided us with sufficient time and evidence of the failure of our political system, we certainly cannot argue that our earliest years after independence had not anticipated the failure with which we are now grappling. Indeed, the earliest years after independence produced a wide body of work, all decrying the inadequacy and unsuitability of the inherited Westminster system of government to the needs of the post-colonial Caribbean. These criticisms had several bases. Trevor Monroe, for instance, felt that the problem resided in the fact that our decolonization was merely constitutional, a reality which he felt resulted in the limiting of our options to to those which would meet the approval of our British colonial masters. He felt that the constitutional approach took off the agenda many options which perhaps would have seen the emergence of more relevant, largely homegrown responses. Moreover, Monroe felt that the path of constitutionalism served to alienate the mass of the population, since the very process of constitutional decolonization involved only the legal-minded political elite in discussions with the British counterparts, while the people were only mere spectators. Others, such as Franz Fanon, felt that the problem resided in the betrayal of what he called the native petty bourgeoisie, who, because of their economic dependency upon the former colonial power, were unable to set the economy on new foundations, nor were they able, due to their lack of creativity, to create new political institutions more suited to the needs of the mass of the population. As Fanon had seen it, the blame was to be placed largely upon the shoulders of those he described as the educated classes. I'm quoting him, "It so happens that the unpreparedness of the educated classes, the lack of practical links between them and the mass of the people, their laziness, and let it be said, their cowardice at the decisive moment of the struggle, will give rise to tragic mishaps. National consciousness, instead of being the all-embracing crystallization of the innermost hopes of the whole people, instead of being the immediate and most obvious result of the mobilization of the people, will be in any case only an empty shell, a crude and fragile travesty of what it might have been." Others like Trinidadian C.L.R. James and Thomas Gittins at the time located the point of the failure of Caribbean democracy in the Caribbean political party. Both Gittins and C.L.R. James saw the political party as an instrument whose ultimate goal was to keep the common people institutionally separated from the center of government. Gittins felt that while the movement towards independence was spearheaded by the mobilized mass, the political party that was created afterwards had the effect of demobilizing the mass mobilization. C.L.R. James, in his famous criticism of the Eric Williams's PNM in party politics in the West Indies, sought to identify the problem in the separation between the party as party and the party as government. As far as James was concerned, the political party, whatever its political form, was an instrument used to separate the government from the party. And as such, in the context of our times, it was an anti-democratic institution. Like Fanon, James too felt that the problem resided in the distance between the local bourgeoisie and intelligentsia on one hand, and the mass of the population on the other. In C.L.R. James's view, the problem of Caribbean democracy resided too much in the local ruling class's belief in the British political system and in the acceptance of the British notion of colonial tutelage with its timetable for the so-called readiness for self-government. As C.L.R. James put it, "By delaying the achievement of self-government, and by the mean and grudging granting so many the vote, so many to become ministers, and all the palaver and so-called education by which the British government claimed that it trained the West Indian population for self-government, a terrible damage was inflicted upon us. In reality, our people were miseducated. Our political consciousness was twisted and broken. Far from being guided to independence by the 1960s, the imperialist government poisoned and corrupted that sense of self-confidence and political dynamic needed for any people about to embark on the uncharted seas of independence and nationhood. The result, therefore, was an intellectual elite which was instinctively hostile to the demands of real change on the part of the people. It was an elite which measured its progress in terms of its ability to conform to British standards. And it was an elite which, in psychological terms, expressed a lack of confidence and even contempt for the underclass. It was an elite which rejected the political aspirations and the modes of expression of the ordinary West Indian. Yet at the same time, this was the very class by which, by virtue of its privileged education, was positioned to lead the trade unions and political parties which were at the forefront of the nationalist struggles. And of course, there was Lloyd Best, with his continuous search for an autonomous Caribbean form, of which his prescription for a macro Senate remains among the most enduring. All of Best's constitutional proposals revolve around the theme of finding a form of government which would allow government to replace politics and which would allow community interests rather than party interests to shape the composition of government. Sevin Ryan tells us that in one of Lloyd Best's schemes, the House of Reps would be complemented by another house, which will be elected on the basis of community interests. This new house will include the corporate and vested interests of the land, that is, the trade unions, business and professional associations, women, sportsmen, etc. In Best words, it would be a huge assembly of interests from the community, each electing the people and changing them as they want, so you get representation and politics. Once you emancipate the people from the executive, you are going to have real competition about who gets jobs, and therefore you are going to get representation. It is clear from these offerings that the question which we have come to address is a very old problem. The problem, wherever it was defined, revolved around the unsuitability of our inherited political system. So this was the way the problem has been historically diagnosed. Sadly, the problem has been compounded with time. There have been some new and significant developments which have further deepened the crisis of Caribbean politics and has rendered even more fleeting the possibility of Caribbean democracy and true representation. Indeed, 50 years into independence, and particularly since the decade of the 1980s, a new world has emerged which has rendered nebulous all the old strategies of our post-colonial development and our aspirations to political democracy. Central to the negation of Caribbean development and democracy has been the new world ushered in by what has come to be called globalization and its ideological handmaiden, neoliberalism. We cannot understand the present challenges to Caribbean democracy without reflecting on the manner in which the present reality of globalization and neoliberalism have changed the world under which the Caribbean attained its independence, and by extension, has changed the world under which Caribbean democracy had been framed. On hindsight, the period between 1960 and the early 1980s can be seen as a golden age for post-colonial state construction and economic development. In that period, there was still a large degree of global legitimacy for even the smallest of states to engage in interventionist social and economic engineering. After a protracted battle to win sovereignty and independence, all our societies, to greater or lesser extents, sought to pursue correctives to the colonial condition. Those correctives required heavy doses of state intervention to widen the education levels, to improve the health service, to improve housing and other social amenities, and to modernize the civil service, making it more responsive to local as distinct from metropolitan needs. All of these progressive developments were sustained by what can be described as a permissive global political economic environment. Among the features of that environment was the presence of the Cold War, which created room through non-alignment for small state domestic growth and development. In philosophical terms, the environment was supported by perspectives which were conducive to independence and self-determination, and which saw the instrumentality of sovereignty and state intervention as important mechanisms through which national development could be pursued. Self-determination implies political democracy, and despite its limitations, it was a period when the first tentative steps to government by the consent of the governed were allowed in our Caribbean region. In looking back, it is clear that some of the principal economic and democratic successes in our region took place in that period, and our post-independence social contracts were given full expression. It was a social contract in which the state was seen as having a minimal responsibility for social welfare. Our farming community was guaranteed an income, irrespective of how rudimentary their production processes were, and public sector workers were guaranteed jobs for life. Underlying these arrangements was a broad agreement that we would embrace democratic norms, in which we pursued social democracy and avoided communism, and stayed within the political and cultural orbit of the West. These were the broad terms of the post-colonial social contract, which sustained Caribbean democracy and development in the first 20 years of our independence, 1960 to 1980. From the 1980s onwards, however, globalization and neoliberalism would usher in a new world which severely damaged the fragile economic framework for development which had been laid and reversed and diminished the limited democratic infrastructure which had been established. This can be seen in many ways. The collapse of the Soviet Union and Eastern European communism made a mockery of the political and ideological conformity with the West, a tremendous strain on our economies, and has led to much social instability. A second feature was the emergence of global trade liberalization and the removal of colonial special trade arrangements. That began first with the synchronization of European trade policy as the EU was taking shape, and it evolved further with the establishment of the WTO out of the GATT, and the impact on the Caribbean of these developments have been direct. Much of the social and political economic crises confronting our society since the early 1990s have sprung from the emergence and application of liberal norms and practices which have removed the economic cushions which once protected our fragile democracies, and with the fact that nothing new has taken their place. A third feature has been the emergence of new ideologies which have impacted on the capacity of the Caribbean state to intervene to pursue locally determined priorities. Once globalization had set in, it now became difficult, if not impossible, for our states to pursue policies consistent with ensuring local citizens' special advantage in the economic opportunities existent in the country. Relatedly, the state itself, its size, its role, and the very idea of sovereignty have also come under attack, and the state has been systematically redefined to a set of functions less resistant to externally determined economic objectives. In such a context, faced with its own powerlessness, the Caribbean state has now responded by resisting democracy and by insulating itself from demands for more democratic inclusion. It is in such a context that we can understand the moves to states of emergency and other authoritarian tendencies on the part of the state. A fourth feature is what I call the negation of democracy and what I call the return of power without responsibility. This final point is of direct relevance to our specific concern about the question of Caribbean democracy. Whilst we often focus on the economic consequences of globalization, we tend to forget that globalization has resulted in the erosion of Caribbean democracy. Under classic colonialism, the state enjoyed power without responsibility. In other words, the British colonial apparatus and its local representatives were able to wield power over our citizens, yet these colonial rulers were neither elected by nor were they accountable to the local population. The colonial state was therefore neither representative of local wishes, nor was it responsible or accountable to any local aspirations. Many of us tend to forget that our independence movements were also democratic movements. By the winning of one man, one vote, we gave ourselves the capacity to elect governments of our own making and who would make decisions according to the wishes of the majority. These governments were to be directly accountable to us, and as a consequence, we could remove them once we felt that they had not conformed to our expectations. Our independence movement therefore moved the center of decision making from the colonial office in London and placed them in the hands of the local population. All of this has been undermined by globalization, which has represented the old colonial problematic of power without responsibility in a new guise. Firstly, our new independent governments are now constrained in their policy choices, and critical and economic decisions are now being made more and more in the IMF, the World Bank, and the G20 than in our domestic cabinet rooms. Whilst the power of our domestically elected governments have decreased, they remain no less accountable for actions over which they have very little or no control. So whilst in the old days, colonial rulers enjoyed power without responsibility, today our local governments have responsibility without power, and international agencies like the IMF now enjoy power without responsibility. All of this negates the very essence of democracy, in which the right to self-determination and government by the consent of the governed are essential parts. A close examination of the assumption of neoliberalism, which is the ideology of globalization, reveals in clear terms the manner in which the ideology of neoliberalism has negated Caribbean democracy. Neoliberalism has several assumptions. They include the privileging of private capital over the social good, the assumption of the economic sphere as given and natural, Was the political space artificial and therefore subject to containment or even disappearance? That's why they want to get the state out of the picture. Thomas Jefferson had said, the less the government, the better. Neoliberalism also implies the privileging of the individual over the social. Margaret Thatcher had told us there is no such thing as a society. Neoliberalism also holds or sees the idea of the state as the facilitator of private capital accumulation at the expense of the protection and enhancement of civil society. Neoliberalism also holds that the state should retreat from the economic sphere and should confine itself to security and labor regulation. Security and labor regulation were the two things that the colonial state always did. But now we're being told that the independent state should concern itself with security and labor regulation as its only two legitimate types of activity. We also have seen with neoliberal ideology the so-called end of ideology upon which is established the assumption that all other options are closed and should be taken off the table. Margaret Thatcher also told us that there is no alternative, a famous Tina. Neoliberalism also holds the idea of the death of politics. The assumption is that all major political questions have been resolved, and the only role left for politics is administration. This leads, in my view, to the rise of technocrats, and I think we saw that clearly in Greece, Italy, and Spain, where you have now non-elected technocrats making critical decisions about the lives of people, and I hold that that is a reversal of democracy. Neoliberalism also speaks to the sacrificing of democracy for efficiency. And I could continue and go on, but I think the point is clear. And these, in my view, in broad terms, capture for us the reality of the present and reveal starkly why, despite our lamentations of the poverty and backwardness of our democratic inheritance, the challenges we face today are qualitatively different, and why we have even greater work to do in fashioning the new democracy that we all aspire towards. And I want to turn now to some broad prescriptions and perspectives on how we can overcome the challenges and begin to work towards fashioning the new democracy. Whenever I am called upon to prescribe alternatives that will usher in a new democracy and a new politics for the Caribbean, I am always moved to frame my prescriptions within the context of the failure of the Caribbean independence project. My contention is that the failure of Caribbean democracy and the failure of Caribbean development within the context of post-1980 globalization and neoliberalism represent nothing more than the failure of the Caribbean independence project itself. In prescribing a new politics and a new democracy for our Caribbean, therefore, our first and most urgent task is to recognize that the first independence revolution has run its course and that the post-colonial Caribbean state as we know it has exhausted all of its developmental possibilities. Once we come to that realization, we will have no choice but to turn our collective attention to the pursuit of the federal option. In this task, we must reflect deeply on the causes of the failure of the West Indies Federation. We must reflect on why federation became the road not taken, and we must reflect on whether, in our present condition, we have not come full circle back to the federal idea. In our reflection, we will perhaps come to the realization that much of the nonsensical politics which we see in many of our Caribbean states today, from backward immigration policies to senseless states of emergency to the continuing hostility to the integration project, all of these headless chicken policies might be springing from the fact that we are trying to make the singular independent Caribbean state do what it once did well, but what it perhaps can no longer do. Our first and most urgent task, therefore, in what I call the second independence revolution, must be to put the federal Humpty Dumpty back together again and seat him with pride and dignity back upon his wall. Secondly, once we accept that the federal option is the only option, we must begin to think about new organizational forms which will serve as the vehicle through which the new integration project will have to be launched. In our reflection, we must consider deeply why it is that a region which has had such a long tradition of grassroots political activism has never once conceived the necessity of organizing in a sustained and deep way a Caribbean integration party. There have been several Caribbean integration movements, or perhaps one continuous movement. But despite all the work of CARICOM and other supranational developmental entities regionally, there has never been a sustained bottom-up movement that exists with the sole and primary aim of organizing a political party whose business is to create a unified political region. The second task of that generation before me, the second task of you who are to lead that second independence revolution, must be to bring to life such a movement. The era of top-down integration has died as surely as the first independence revolution has exhausted itself. And it is the challenge of our generation to develop the organizational capacity and the stamina to give birth to new grassroots organizational forms which have a pan-Caribbean agenda and a pan-Caribbean structure. But in our creation of a new pan-Caribbean political structure and in our creation of new pan-Caribbean political movements, we have a responsibility to transcend and reject the political party. One of the most consistent perspectives in all the prescriptions for new models of governance that I have seen from Lloyd Best, through to C.L.O. James, through to Douglas Hall, is the insistence that the political party must be transcended. In aspiring towards the second independence revolution, therefore, we must start from the position that the political party as we know it, the political party in its present form, must be smashed completely and put aside forever. To paraphrase Karl Marx, we must resolve to put the whole machinery of the political party where it belongs, into the Museum of Antiquities, side by side of the spinning wheel and the bronze axe. The political party in its earliest manifestation, in our context, emerged as the vehicle through which the disenfranchised masses could register their voices on the political landscape. It originally emerged as an instrument of liberation. It emerged as the principal organ of nationalist and working class organization. And there is no doubt that the political party in its earlier incarnation served the useful and historical purpose of smashing the colonial apparatus. But today, 50 years after independence, the political party has been transformed from an instrument of liberation to an instrument of oppression. The political party has become nothing but a crude and blunt instrument for one section of society to disenfranchise and marginalize the other section of society. When it falls into the wrong hands, the political party is sometimes no different from any other petty criminal organization. Just as the political party served as the vehicle of the first independence revolution, then we cannot move towards the second independence revolution without creating new and relevant forms of political organization. These new and relevant forms of political organization must resolve and overcome all the old deficiencies in democracy, representation, accountability, transparency, and participation currently experienced with the party in its present form. So our third task, as we seek to shape the second independence revolution, will be to imagine, identify, discover, and create the new forms of political organization which will take us to where we want to go. In this regard, we must be mindful, as I was arguing earlier, that we cannot sit in our armchairs and imagine these new political forms. If we pay close attention to the quarrel between James Millet and Lloyd Best, for example, you will see that James Millet's concern was that Best had a tendency to prescribe from his head idealized notions of new political forms, sometimes removed from concrete reality. I propose instead that in our search for new political forms, that we start from the concrete experience of practice. It is only the concrete experience of practice which will throw up the form that we seek and will guide us to what is possible. In this regard, I wish to suggest that in our search for these new forms, that we pay close attention to the existing experiences of Occupy Wall Street and the Arab Spring, as they may provide useful hints as to where our future organizational experiences may reside. I wish to suggest, too, that we pay close attention to the organizational forms adopted by the Obama campaign, the first campaign, its use of technology, and I'm happy to see that you have technology on your agenda for this afternoon, its use of technology, the decentralization of decision-making, the concentric circles revolving further and further outward from the center, but held together by the common purpose and the initiative of the center. No more is the top-down, bottom-heavy form of organization suited to the new times. But as technology, education, and information spread, we must open ourselves to imagining and creating new forms of organization that are horizontal, that are flatter, and that are created not on the premise of the wisdom of the top and the ignorance of the bottom, but are based on the realization that the education and information provided by the new technological forms are great levelers and require new organizational forms suited to the times. People like Alvin Toffler have written extensively on the way in which our technological foundations help to shape our political systems. Long before Toffler, Karl Marx had given us the blueprint with his famous assertion that the technology of the handmill gives you the society of the feudal lord, while the technology of the steam mill gives you the society of the industrial bourgeois. We need to reflect deeply on what of society that the technology of the internet, the microchip, and the BlackBerry now gives to us. Toffler has asserted persuasively that the vote is really an industrial invention that mirrors the industrial production of the assembly line. Just as the assembly line produces a finished product in which the input of the worker is minimal, the turning of a screw or the tightening of a bolt, then so is the act of lining up to vote, equivalent to our limited input in the political machinery. Representative democracy results in as much alienation from the final product as is the worker in the factory whose job is to tighten a bolt as the unfinished goods wind its way towards his station on the assembly line. It is for this reason that Maurice Bishop called the vote two-second democracy every 5 years, and why the French philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau described the vote as a simultaneous exercise in and surrender of sovereignty. The very moment when we make the X on the ballot paper is the same moment when we surrender our sovereignty to our representatives. Both Rousseau and Bishop were searching for a form that allowed us to retain our sovereignty whilst participating in the political lives of our societies without surrendering our power to the representatives. When we think about it clearly, we see that all the forms of 20th century political organization, from the Communist Vanguard Party form of Lenin to our own liberal democratic form, are really forms of representation in which a few act on behalf of the many. This, indeed, is the very meaning of representation. It is for this reason that Rousseau argues that for the emergence of a new participatory democracy, and why Toffler and others argue that the new technologies of today make it possible to move beyond representation and to adopt new forms of political participation. When we think of the possibilities of the radio call-in program to democracy, that is, the combination of simple radio and telephone technology, we get a sense of how much deeper the possibilities may be when we begin to tap into the full potential of the internet and the BlackBerry for our democratic participation. I urge that we study these realities as we propose a new democracy for the future Caribbean. Finally, as we build the second independence revolution, I urge that we make an inventory of all the old questions and demands that were put on the agenda during the first independence revolution. And having made that inventory, we should then produce a balance sheet of what was achieved, what failed, what is no longer relevant or critical, and what is still essential. Our inventory will constitute the political and developmental program of our second independence revolution. Overcoming racism and white supremacy, the social protection of the vulnerable, the control of the economy and its resources in the interest of the majority, the democratization of the Caribbean state, the demand for a new and relevant constitution, the need to transcend Westminster, the need to provide housing, health, and education for all, and the need to protect our sovereignty, our right to sovereignty, and to pursue our own self-determination, all must be part of the programmatic aspiration of the second independence revolution. Of course, we may need to add new issues to our program, like the defense and protection of the environment, the fight against corruption, drugs, and money laundering, and other issues relevant to our time. In particular, too, we need to pay special attention to all the previous demands which have been placed on the agenda for deepening Caribbean democracy and for making our politics more meaningful. Our demands for the right to recall parliamentarians in mid-term, the need for term limits on prime ministers, the demand for institutionalized primaries for candidate selection at the continent level, the need for integrity legislation, the need for party financing legislation, and all the other demands offered by Best and others for bringing politics closer to the people and for limiting the power of elected politicians should form part of our agenda, both at the local level as well as the regional level. This is all I can offer at this stage, and I hope that I have said enough to contribute to your thinking about the new politics and the new democracy that we are struggling to give birth to. I have deliberately avoided a detailed prescription since, as I have argued, it is only in the concrete struggle that the minute details of what is possible can emerge. What I can assert, however, is that the new realities of our time, the crisis of the present moment, the material reality of the possibilities of the new technology, the concrete example of the current practices in Occupy Wall Street and other forms of political organization, as well as the shift in Caribbean consciousness, which has placed new demands on the table, suggest that the moment is ripe for change. Whilst, therefore, the demands for a new politics and a new democracy is as old as Caribbean independence itself, I close optimistic in the possibilities of the present and certain that our concrete material condition now make our aspirations realizable. I look forward to meeting with you and joining with you at the beckoning rendezvous of victory.